Hello. Hello, 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 hello. I want to share this and I am just going to record it. And people can look at it later and I'm going to download it and put it on my YouTube. And I want to as I've been posting things about the war in Gaza. I mentioned some things about, follow the money trail, and about investors and oil that was found off the shore of Gaza, and perhaps there's more reasons for this. But then there also is a spiritual reason, because I think behind everything that is a clash, a contention, dissension, there is something that the enemy wants to prevent. So he presents opportunities to distract, disrupt, detain, delay, and destroy. So when we see the enemy, and I'm talking about the enemy of God, causing wars and famines and causing all kind of things in the world. Famines most sometimes an act of God, but in this case, wars. There's something behind it other than just the money trail. Because we know money is the root of all evil, and there's war and money. There's money in war. But sometimes the enemy wants to prevent something from happening that is a good thing. Nobody really considered, few people considered the fact that they're Palestinian Christians, Nazarenes, and it's a, I can't remember the other name they have, but, and they're not just ones who just have been evangelized and converted. Some go back to the time of Christ, following the crucifixion of Christ, when Philip traveled from Jerusalem to Gaza and he converted Christians then. And then there was, in the 5th century, there was a bishop that traveled and converted individuals from paganism to Christianity, and he built a church. I think that was one of the churches that was recently bombed. It was a Christian church for Palestinians. And then you have, current to date, not only going back to the biblical time, back to the 5th century, but you have Christians that have visited Palestine and have brought, they're missionaries and they have converted Palestinians to Christianity. And believe it or not, because of the plight that all Palestinians share in that area with living under occupation and under colonial rule with limited rights and limited opportunities, economic opportunities to improve themselves and the precariousness of being considered a criminal for anything and and jailed and imprisoned women, men, as you see when they were trying to when they were negotiating hostages release, it was on both sides. So with them understanding that living in that uncertainty, that kind of oppressive state, that one step above apartheid, Islamic Palestinians and Christian Palestinians lived in some type of solidarity. That means there's more of an opportunity to understand Christianity and to share. Maybe the enemy is afraid that of this the spread of the gospel by Palestinians, because they were fueled with living under those conditions that help solidify their faith and their and God, and that he was keeping them. So it says that I was reading one account that Palestinians were sending three million, three thousand, to every 1 million Christians. They were the highest in terms of sending missionaries abroad. I mean, because come on, you would want to get out of there and tell your story. But in getting out and telling your story, it was rewriting the narratives of what was actually going on that the UN was ignoring, and some legislators, except for Bernie Sanders and a few others, did not ignore. They knew there was something to be dealt with before we got to this place of Hamas taking hostages, and before all the bombings and all that. With all the things along the way, there was putting their head in the sand and ignoring this situation until this hostility broke out. And now people are looking at the history and looking at the cause, and look, and some people are still totally aligning themselves with Israel and saying it is okay, carte blanche, by any means possible. And so it's okay to bomb hospitals and churches and schools and civilians. Churches, homes, and schools and civilians. I remember I'm watching television shows, and you know, when police would risk letting an assailant get away if he had a hostage. You know, but yet to just bomb children, to say go to a safe place and then bomb that place. So, you know, we're aware that the oil that was found off the shore and in the Palestinian area. So maybe I was thinking maybe that was it. Maybe, you know, moving people out of the land they could not claim. I don't know what's going to happen with that. Then I thought, well, you know, this is an economy stimulus package, you know, because now you get to try your warfare bombs and your ammo and get to, you know, replenish some of that, and so that everybody you know is making money in with the stock and commodities and all those minerals and resources that go into making those tanks and those bombs. And across the world they were interested, someone is making money, and so they were okay with it. So yes, military, and yes, money. And then I thought about, hey, construction companies will have to come together, and people will be getting contracts with the government to go ahead and repair that with an infrastructure that will be so wired. If you poot, they know you did it, okay? They're talking about, so I think that even that is in the making. Like, who's going to build this up, and what technology are we going to put in this place that if we continue to make it an occupation zone, what can we do insidiously to watch the people and control them? What AI can we bring in? So investments, commodities, stock, all these countries, all the way to Africa, where they get these, what they need to make what they need. Every country is probably also interested in the oil offshore and when they're going to start drilling that, you know. And then the fact that Christianity was spreading and had the possibility of spreading, because the Palestinians were leaving the land and telling their story. They were going to Canada, they're going to America, they're going to some Arab countries, and they're telling their story. So no matter what the U.S. and other people choose to report, they were telling their story. And they were legitimizing their story. So now, they attack a church. And that was, I believe, was a Greek Orthodox church. So these are not just Islamic churches. So I'm wondering, what are the Greek Orthodox churches and the Anglican churches and the Catholic churches and the Lutheran churches and the Methodist churches that went over and evangelized and had churches over there for decades. What are these Christians doing to support Palestinian Christians? Palestinian Christians who not only had to live under this occupation, and although they were living in solidarity with the Islam who shared the same fate, but in some sense, they were also marginalized and alienated and discriminated against because they were Christians by their Islamic brothers, family members who were wondering, why are you leaving this faith and becoming a Christian? And now that how they must taunt Palestinian Christians who have not had the opportunity to flee, who are still there. I wonder if they say, maybe you should not have left Islam. Is this what your Christian God does? Where are your Christian friends now? This country built on Christian principles, where is America? We're crying out, where is the Christians in America? So I understand our interpretation of, you know, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and these were people who protected the seed that would bring forth Christ and also ensure that he was crucified, which was part of God's will, because if Christ be lifted up, he would draw all men unto him. Okay? So this was a part of the process. This was a part of the plan. I'm wondering if they're saying, where is your Savior now? You know that all souls belong to God, and the soul that receives Jesus Christ is considered a son of God. But when the blood falls like Abel, it speaks. God hears it. And he's still telling us we are our brother's keeper. Our brothers in Palestine. Our Messianic brothers, our Nazarene brothers, Messianic Jews, our Nazarene brothers, we're all brothers and sisters. In fact, the Bible would say, he is not a Jew who's one outwardly through the circumcision of the flesh, you know, the foreskin that they did in Abraham's time, well, continue to do. But he is a Jew who's one through the circumcision of the heart. So we're at a whole new level of representation that God knows we are his people because he did something awesome. This is what he did for all people, all nations who call upon him as not only Jesus, but their Lord and Savior Jesus. This is what he did. He says, I'm going to live in you. I'm going to walk into you, and I'm going to be unto your God, and you shall be my people, and I shall take out your stony heart and make it a heart of flesh, pliable, malleable, something I can work with, something I can that can contain me, because I'm going to put the triune Son of God. He is going to save you and bring you the Holy Spirit that's going to bring you into me that I got, that you can come boldly to the throne room of grace and receive mercy in time of need. And God himself is living inside of us through this process where God is now, through Christ, being we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So this new place we have in our heart is this renewed mind and this heart that God gives us, that he agrees with himself in us, because we kept breaking the commandments, we kept breaking our covenant, as when I talk about we, when I'm talking about the children of Israel, were an example of what man would do, and that man needed a savior. He had received the corruptible seed, and he needed the incorruptible seed of Jesus Christ. And with Jesus coming into her life and that blood on the, and then holies of holies speaking that man has a right to be here, God transcends his law. And when we say, let his blood be upon us and our children's children, that was said by the children of Israel, that was the plan. So in that plan, he comes to live inside of us and in our hearts. That gives us an opportunity to be one with another, one God, one faith, one baptism. And Jesus, the Son of God, the blood of Jesus made that possible. So the truth of that word can be revealed, and the Holy Spirit sheds about, puts truth in our inward parts and sheds about truth by love. The Holy Spirit sheds love abroad in our heart, that love, so that God can live there. And in that fellowship of faith, it is love that brings us all together, one nation under God, but one nation from several different tongues, because we come together in love, made possible by Jesus Christ and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in us, bringing us into the fellowship of the faith. So whether you're Palestinian Jew, Nazarene Jew, whether you're Greek Orthodox or you're Anglican, or you are Baptist, Lutheran, Episcopalian, if you believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, and he's your Lord and Savior, then we're all in the body of Christ. And so we are all his children. So it was the children of Israel long ago that they weren't a special people. They were some small people and significant people, but God chose them. It didn't say they were better than everybody else. It's just they had a covenant and they had a Savior. And now we have that covenant. We have that Savior. And God is looking at this in a whole nother level, not just one people, but every knee shall bow, and those who choose Jesus Christ as Lord shall confess Jesus is Lord. Now, all of us now are considered Jew based on what God spiritually intended. And it's no longer the land, because we're saying, well, they have a right to this land. It's not the temple anymore, because we are the temple. And it's not a land anymore, because the kingdom of God is not a tangible thing. It's not meat or drink. It's righteousness, our righteous God in Christ Jesus. It's peace. He's our peace and joy. And his presence is fullness of joy in the Holy Ghost. That is the kingdom of God. And we are called to advance the kingdom of God, not to say, get this place by any means necessary, because that's changed. Just like when they came, when Jesus came and they said the government's going to be on his shoulders, and they thought he was just going to overthrow the Roman government. But that wasn't the process. That wasn't the plan. So we're fighting over a land, but that's not, God is intended for the kingdom of God to be his people, where he dwells. And when we're fitly joined together, we become the bride of the body of Christ, the bride of Christ. And we reflect in the earth God's glory. So maybe the enemy is aware that something special was happening in Palestine with Palestinian Christians and the Messianic Christians. And them having their Messianic concerts, and there was an issue with something happening at one of the concerts there, but they were doing things. Maybe they were afraid that the revolution of believers would change the status quo. Maybe they were afraid that even with this revolution of Messianic Jews and Nazarene Palestinian Christians, Messianic Christians and Messianic Jews who are Christians and Palestinian Nazarene Christians would come together, and their families would come together, and something wonderful would happen. Something wonderful would happen. We would begin to evangelize. But now, perhaps they're saying, where are the Christians? Now that the churches are bombed, where are the Christians? Are they praying for us? Have they forgotten us? Has the world of Christians all over the world, because these churches are like international churches. They're not a church on a corner. These are international churches who know that church was bombed. Are they poised and ready to rebuild that church, to get that territory, that area back, to rebuild the church so there's a place where they assemble? But ultimately, what God is building, what God is building is his people. He said, into one body, his people, who individually represents sanctuaries, living epistles, representatives of God in the earth. So that when we come together in unity, no matter what our ethnic and background is and our faith, but those who believe in Jesus Christ, when we come together as one, the world will know that Christ has come. Maybe the enemy is afraid that right there in Bethlehem, right there, that something phenomenal was going to happen. I don't know. But it's really sad with everything that's going on. It's really, really sad. Yeah, still pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And it's not just the peace of Jerusalem, but it's the peace of the Palestinians who live there, the peace of the Christians who live there, the peace of Islamic people who live there. Peace. That we may walk together in unity until our Father returns, Jesus Christ returns, and brings us home to that destination that is not an earthly destination. So anyway, be encouraged, and please pray for Palestinians that, as well as our Israel. I am not supporting what Hamas has done, and I am not supporting what is happening with the bombing of civilians. Like Christians, and like, believe it or not, many Jewish people and Palestinians, apart from the leadership, and again, there must be a lot of money to be made, I am for peace. I want to share this one song. It goes like this. The windows of the world are covered with rain. When will those black skies turn to blue? Everybody knows when little children play. They need a sunny day to grow straight and tall. Let the sun shine through the windows of the world covered with rain. There must be something that you and you and I can do. Everybody knows when boys grow into men, they start to wonder when. And boys aren't growing into men. Children are dying. Right out of neonatal. Dying. In Palestine. We are our brother's keepers. Let's hold our government accountable. Let's hold the United Nations accountable. To make it a place where people can live together and have rights and be treated like human beings and not have situations that fuel to promote violence. Because even in the retaliation, violence only begets violence. But know that passiveness begets nothing. And we know what happened with being passive before. We need to do something. We need to pray. We need to pray. And we need to write and find out what they're doing to make a difference. If we're sending money there, our money is like a yes and amen. Let this be so. Meantime, companies are making money, sending in ammunition. We are borrowing money to send money. So other countries are making money with interest. We're replenishing that equipment, the munitions. So we need to get resources from other countries, and they're making money. So as they're wiping the land out and moving the people away, the Gaza Strip, then they will begin to consider mining the oil that's offshore and taking hold of that wealth. So these world leaders can continue to make money on lives of others. And money is the root of all evil. God bless. Take the meat, throw away the bones. Three things. Money trail. And what does the enemy want to keep man from doing and achieving and advancing the gospel and the kingdom of God on earth? God bless you. Do pray for Israelis and the Palestinians and all of the Islamic and Jewish people around the world who, because of this, might be experiencing hate crimes because of this response that the UN could have did something long ago, and Israel itself could have had the security that this didn't happen. But they let the chip be pushed off their shoulder, and now they have an opportunity to do what is being done.